warm greetings to BCCI, particularly to President Benedicto, Ambassador Benedicto Yuwiko, to the chairperson of the Education Committee, old-time friend, Dr. And of course, to the chair of the Committee on R&D of BCCI, Dr. Ruben Naide Jr., and two directors who are present, led by Director Alberto Penix and also Perry Pereira, who spoke before me. I would like to thank PCCI for inviting me to have the opportunity to present R&D in government in this particular forum. I will be sharing slides, so I can do it here. PCCI's staff do the sharing for me? Thank you, Russell. Just enlarge it a little bit. Wala. Yan. Okay. So let me start with this first slide. The title is R&D in Government. We move on to the next slide, please. And we show here the so-called Harmonized National Research and Development Agenda. It is required that every administration shall adopt a Harmonized National R&D Agenda, which is approved at the level of NEDA. So we have five components here: basic research, health and agriculture, including aquatic and natural resources, industry, energy, and the emerging technologies, as well as disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation. Next slide, please. In the crafting of the National Research and Development Agenda, the different branches, or shall we say departments of government, which funds R&D are included or are consulted. So DA, for example, CHED, DOH, and the other departments. Next slide, please. We have instituted some improvements in and one of the changes that we have adopted is the synchronization, okay, of our system for the different councils. And so the DOST grant in aid program now has a single call for proposal for each area. So unlike before, when proposals are given at any time of year and we evaluate as they come, this time we have a single call for industry, energy, and emerging technologies, another call for basic research, another call for agriculture, another call for health. And these proposals that are submitted during this period of, for example, this year, 2021, are evaluated at different levels until we come up with an approved set that is for implementation in 2022. Naturally, because of limitations in budget, we can only reach up to a certain number. They are prioritized. Next slide, please. So in the new monitoring and evaluation protocol that we created, to help improve our process performance and to achieve our targeted results of R&D. We have adopted this system that has a target of a project evaluation period of 40 working days. So this is from the time the proposals are received as complete in documentation up to the time when our executive committee gives action, whether they are approved or not. Next slide, please. Now, to give you an idea of the budget of government, this 2021, the total national R&D budget as contained in our GAA is 17 billion, 17.15 billion pesos. So, unfortunately, the percentage of R&D funding, while in absolute terms there was an increase, the percentage has gone down from 0.8% in 2019 to 0.4% in 2021. In other words, not even one half of our GAA is devoted to R&D. We had the highest in the case of DOST in the year 2018. Next slide, please. So now let us take a look at the examples of the successful R&D programs, priority R&D programs that were funded by DOST grants in aid. In the area of health, this is our Tuktas Lunas programs, program which envisions to produce world-class medicines derived from Philippine biodiversity, leveraging on local expertise. So in 2020, the program supported 62 projects implemented by 23 institutions with a total funding of 222.5 million pesos. Since 2013, total investments in this program is about 1.5 billion with 28 institutions benefiting from the grants. It was unlike in the 80s and 90s when there was only one institution doing our R&D on drug development. This is UP Manila. This time there are at present 23 that are actively involved, okay, in the Tuklas Lunas program. We also are doing projects on biomedical devices. You can see there the titles Tayo and Agapay, and as the names suggest, okay, the Agapay project is an upper limb robotic exoskeleton device to support physical rehab of Filipino patients, okay, and the Tayo project was developed. It's also a robotic rehabilitative for the trunk and lower extremities of patients who suffered from stroke and injuries. Then we have the malnutrition reduction program, which is of course a national program. We now have 33 facilities for complementary food production in 17 regions and 33 provinces in our country. There will be 8 new ones coming up this 2021-2022. Next slide, please. Now, let's move to the area in industry, energy, and emerging technologies. One of them is on transportation. During the previous administration, my predecessor, Secretary Montejo, focused on the train. So we developed the hybrid electric train, the hybrid electric road train, and the automated AGT, automated guideway transit. And so the hybrid electric train has passed all the tests and has been turned over to PNR. It actually ran commercially for a while, but now I think they were not used. There are new trains for PNR, by the way, which are all imported. Now the hybrid electric road train, we developed two models, and one of them is in Isabela, one of them is in General Santos. And this coming August, there will be actually a signing between the provincial government of Isabela and a consortium of local manufacturers to produce two more units of the hybrid electric road train. So that is a very good indicator of a transfer of technology. Now, in the case of the automated guideway transit, we have now teamed up with the DPWH and DOTR, the Department of Transportation, so that we can be given a budget for a longer track so that we can do the test. Okay, we cannot do the test for the automated guideway transit with the existing 400 meters of HDT track. We need at least around 3.5 to 4 kilometers of track to fully undertake all the tests needed. Now, this year we will be launching our hybrid trimaran, passenger cargo vessel that uses multi-engine and alternative energy source from ocean waves. So you can see there were delays because, you know, the difficulty in procurement certain items and, of course, the constraints in mobility, but still we target that this will be out before the end of the year. The vessel can carry 100 passengers, 4 vans, and 15 motorcycles. One of the benefits that we have is that the our partner here, the private sector partner, we have also an academia partner, the Aklan State University, and this one actually is a company that was established by former shipbuilding workers in Norway. And so while this is being done, they got many orders for smaller boats, actually, particularly those that are applying the route to Boracay, okay, and the ones that go to Guimaras. Next slide, please. We have here some new developments in our R&D on forest products. So you can see there a project that developed a bullet-resistant vest from engineered bamboo. Okay, so the vest is light enough for use in combat and 700% cheaper than most imported body armors. The Institute also launched the Bamboo Musical Instruments Innovation Program in 2018. That aims to provide the country's bamboo musical instrument makers with science-based solutions in terms of sound quality, playability, tuning, and durability. We want to preserve the indigenous bamboo musical instruments that are found in different regions of the country and particularly in different communities of indigenous people. Now, let us go to the next slide where one of our very successful programs now is the R&D on textiles. So first, we established the Natural Dye Center to strengthen the textile industry. Okay, so they have we have now a production and dyeing facility in Batangas. And then we established the Regional Yarn Production and Innovation Center located at the ISAT University campus in Yagao, Iloilo. This is the Iloilo Science and Technology University that produces 50 kilograms of natural textile fiber, blended yarns of cotton with abaca or pineapple leaf, okay, a day. And you can see the setup that is really, shall we say, up to date in terms of technology. And it has sparked very active, shall we say, production of raw materials in Iloilo, particularly the raw materials I mentioned, cotton, abaca, and pineapple. Okay, so the manual system of producing yarn has become very unattractive for younger people that we need to produce using this modern setup. And the effect of that is really the revitalization of the weaving industry that produces local textiles in that area. Example would be the Jabulon. Now we move on to, of course, next slide. Something that has been occupying our stories for technology during the past few years, and this is the R&D on space technology. We have the Philippine Microsat program, which is the country's first initiative in developing the country's capability in small satellite technology. And in the 4 years of implementation, we launched two microsatellites. This is the Wata-1 and the Wata-2, and two nanosatellites Maya 1 and Maya 2. All of these technologies are outputs of R&D, which is partnership of government, DOST, the academe, in this case, the University of the Philippines in Diliman, and we are now looking at how industry can come in. Now, next slide shows us some of the initiatives for COVID-19, and they fall under different categories. For example, our Xbox is our telemetering for health, okay? Telemetry for health. We originally developed that to be a way of specialized diagnosis, particularly for patients in very remote areas, so that the RxBox can transmit, okay, a certain life signs to third specialty or tertiary hospitals where we have experts in the cities, so that they can help in the diagnosis. And then we have, of course, the faster model, the disease model for COVID-19, developed by DOST through the researchers of Ateneo de Manila, and with the help of the Department of Health and also the National Institutes of Health of UP. And this faster model is the one being officially used by our interagency task force on emerging infectious diseases. And then we have, of course, the first RT-PCR detection kit in our country, which came out very, very fast, okay? By April 5 of 2020, we had already FDA approval. The reason is that we had already the programs existing dealing with other diseases. For example, the faster had developed models for dengue, and typhoid fever and measles. And then in the case of the diagnostic kits, we already had the dengue diagnostic kit, and about to be launched was the leptospirosis diagnostic kit. But then when we received the genome sequence of RT-PCR of the COVID-19, we immediately shifted to COVID-19. Next slide, please. We also have other startup initiatives regarding COVID-19, like these different products that were developed by startup companies. Okay, these are private groups, okay, that did not even benefit from R&D help from us. But of course, when these products came up, and today we already have the innovative startup app, we can now extend assistance to them in the further R&D and commercialization. So you have the Go Clean Chamber developed by the Azure Technologies, which is a startup coming from Apua University. We have the specimen collection booths here that was developed by FAME Incorporated. Actually, this is a startup originally intended to develop communication systems for maritime and air transportation. And then we have the thermal scanners. This was developed by alumni and faculty from Far Eastern University. Project Ramdam is a relief allocation management distribution and monitoring system developed at UP, and many others. Next slide, please. Now, let us go to what we are thinking in terms of long-term R&D programs, and we hope that the next administration of DOST will continue with this. Okay, I think this is one benefit we had at DOST, that even with the changes in administration, there was a continuity in most of the programs. And I can speak authoritatively on that, because I was with DOST. My first second month to DOST was in 1982. That was almost 40 years ago, and I have served under 5 presidents, so I have seen the continuity of many of the programs. Kaya lang yung budget, maliit. Okay. So in terms of long-term R&D programs, health sufficiency is the priority. In fact, we have this proposed legislation, the Virology and Vaccine Science and Technology Institute of the Philippines, and we have revived the pharmaceutical R&D at the Industrial Technology Development Institute, and now formed the Pharmaceutical Development Center within ITDI of UOST. Next slide, please. A Another long-term R&D program is in defense and security. We have ongoing programs with the Navy, with the Armed Forces, with the Philippine Army, and this is really to strengthen our defense and security capabilities. Next slide, please. We have long-term programs in nuclear science for energy, health, agriculture, and industry. And one of our priority projects is in the area of health. Do you know that according to statistics, there are around 400,000 Filipinos who die of cancer without even knowing that they have cancer because of the inaccessibility to the CT scan that are needed. And so we are hoping that we can put up these facilities so that it can be more affordable. Next slide, please. And we have also long-term R&D programs that are supportive of the creative arts, tourism, and the service industries. You know, this is one of the 10 items in the 10-point economic agenda of the President, President Duterte, in 2016. And we were really surprised to see one of the 10 was the promotion of science and technology and the creative arts to promote innovations for inclusive development. So we are doing that right now. Next slide, please. Now, still on the long-term R&D programs, and this is one especially dedicated to PCCI. This is the Cradle for Industry. You know, Cradle means collaborative R&D to leverage the Philippine, to leverage the economy. And this is really an attraction for companies to invest in R&D in partnership with R&D institutions like the ones found in the universities. Okay, so they put up counterparts for the research that will address the problem or the objective of the company. Okay, and then we put in certain relatively big amount, relatively big in terms of percentage, but in absolute terms we have a limit. Okay, to carry out the R&D. Next slide, please. So we are moving from company collaboration now to industry level collaboration. And this is the other one that we are very proud of, thinking about inclusive and sustainable development. We thought that the best way to expand our scientific and R&D capability is to support research centers in the regions. So because of this program, we now have a total of 35 approved and existing niche research centers in the regions. Okay. Most of the first ones are dealing with agriculture and life sciences, but since last year, our approvals are already in the area of industry, energy, and emerging technologies, including health. So we have now 35 approved for this, and it is really motivating our researchers in the regions, particularly to address the problems that are unique to them in the region, and to also take advantage of opportunities that are also unique in the region. Next slide, please. Now, Cradle has approved 30 projects, 71 projects so far in 10 regions with an investment of $325 million. Next slide, please. This is just one example of a Cradle project. This is a collaborative project between the Batangas Egg Producers Cooperative, okay, because of their problem of the ugly eggs. You know, these are the eggs that will not pass the market, okay, because they are very small, because of so many, shall we say, undesirable characteristics or features. And so UP College Home Economics researchers did for them the development of many products, not exactly new, okay, but new in the Philippines, okay. So yung mga egg white powder, yung mga eggs na pwede mong gamitin that are already in bulk, okay, particularly for institutional users, and also different innovative products like chocolate with egg or milk with egg, okay, drinks that they produce. Next slide, please. Now, we also have an opportunity now for experts in specific areas to go out of their original area of activity, I mean geographically. So these are the leaders have been experts in their own universities, in their own research institutions, but now we are giving them an opportunity to help other research groups in the regions, okay? Like the nicer ones that we have developed, so they can be stationed there up to 1 year to help and to assist. Okay, this gives them an opportunity to share their know-how. And at the same time, you know, many of them, for example, are retirees. Okay, and that gives them an opportunity to continue using their expertise in different institutions. Next slide, please. Now, we opened a new program under Science for Change program, and this is the Business Innovation to Science and Technology for Industry. This is something similar to our Small Enterprise Technology Trading Program or SETUP. In SETUP, we give them access to funds so that they can buy the hardware and software they need for updated technology production. This time, we give them an opportunity to have access to hardware and software that they will need for R&D internally in their enterprise. So we have here three examples, and the amount that have been approved that they can have access to, and they have to repay without interest, just like in SETUP, is Herbanec, which is a producer of herbal drugs with 11.7 million, BioAssets, which is now doing the production of diagnostics for animal diseases, 15.9 million, and Nanotronics, which is actually in the development of nanotech materials from indigenous plants with 5 million. This one needs more promotion, and we hope that we can increase the number of beneficiaries. Next slide, please. Now, we have a pending bill, the Science for Change bill, that actually hopes to institutionalize those programs that I have presented, the NEEDS Research Center in the regions, the RD Leaders Program, the collaborative research to leverage the economy, and also the business innovation through science and technology. The principal author is Congressman Joey Salceda. And we were able to get a video from him stating the importance of this piece of legislation. Next slide, please. Now, we have shown that even with our limited resources, the so-called innovation inputs, we get more innovation outputs. And that has been recognized internationally through the Global Innovation Index, particularly for the period between 2014 to 2020, we rose from number 50 out of 125 economies to, from number 100 out of 125 economies to number 50 out of 131 economies. And it has been recognized that this was really a very, shall we say, a good accomplishment. And then in 2021, during the report of UNCTAD, they singled out this particular information wherein there are countries, okay, which actually have a relatively low GDP, and therefore their expected rank, okay, in the innovation ranking is only at a certain level, but they have been at a much higher level given the even the small GDPs that they have. And in terms of what they call overperformance, you know, so this is the number of levels above the expected, for your GDP. The Philippines was number two only to India because we were 57 ranks higher than what was predicted. Okay, so that is an indication that we can really do if only we had the given the necessary support. Next slide, please. And I'm this is the actually the completion of my presentation, but I would just like to leave a few short messages. Number one, why R&D funds have increased, okay, in the past years? As we have seen, the increase is very small compared to the increase in our GDP and compared to the increase in our budget. Okay, so we actually need more, and we have shown our ability to absorb. Number two, we have shown that we can do it, and the last slide shows it. Our performance in the Global Innovation Index, wherein our innovation outputs, okay, did much better than our innovation inputs. And the UNCTAD report showing that we are number two in terms of overperformance in relation to GDP. My third message is that in the Science for Change program that we have, where our strategy really is geared towards inclusive and sustainable development, the four components that we have so far has shown good results. Our niche research centers in the region is showing results better than we have expected. They have been producing results faster than we have expected. Secondly, our collaborative research, this is between industry and academia and the research institutions, has shown that this is a good way of increasing our investments in R&D. With some investments coming from us, these are leveraged with investments coming from the university and from the enterprises. And we also have seen that our R&D leaders, our experts, okay, it has shown, that program has shown that they're willing to share their expertise, okay, outside of their traditional area of work. And in the case of BIST, the Business Innovation in Science and Technology, we have seen that SMEs want to do R&D on their own. They only need, of course, the capability and access to resources to start it. So my last message is that we have to elevate. DOST and PCCI have been long-term partners, but I think we have to elevate our collaboration beyond seminars and conferences. Okay, our industry association members within PCCI would be, I think, a good, shall we say, medium for higher levels of collaboration. We need to see their R&D roadmap so that we can plan in relation to their own targets. Marami pong salamat sa inyong lahat.
Okay, thank you, Secretary De La Peña, for that very informative presentation and for gracing our event, sir. Sir, maraming pong salamat. Now, let's now move on to our open forum. As I have mentioned earlier, the Q&A box in your screen could be used to ask questions. So sa mga gusto po at mayroon pong tanong po dyan, po, pwede niyo pong gamitin o isulat niyo po ang inyong tanong sa Q&A na nandiyan po sa inyong screen. Sir, may katanungan po rito para po sa inyo. Babasahin ko lang po. Ito po, galing po kay Dr. Ruben. Last year, during your talk in the PCCI National Education Forum, you shared good news on the improved world research and development ranking of the Philippines. Any update on this, sir?
Yeah, the 2021 rankings will be announced in September, later than the usual July. I already inquired and they said they will release it in September. We are very hopeful that we can still inch up a little higher, because my personal target is that we will reach the top one-third by 2022.
Galing, sir. So, mayroon pa po siyang follow-up question, sir. Is the budget of 17 billion will translate to the country's improvement in the research and development?
Well, as I said, malayo-malayo yan from the standard that UNESCO has been using, at least 1% of the GDP should be spent on R&D. Kaya lang, alam naman natin kung gaano hirap ngayon ang finances. But so far, we got support from the Economic Development Cluster supporting our bid to reach 10 billion in terms of budget for 2022. And that this will hopefully reach a budget of around 40 billion in 5 years' time.
Okay, sir. Ito pa po isa pang katanungan. May I ask the good secretary if DOST has research programs on alternative sustainable materials in the food industry?
In the ano? Which industry?
On alternative sustainable materials in the food industry, sir. Food.
Food. Sustainable. Well, medyo mahirap intindihin yung tanong. Okay. Alternative materials for food. Okay. So siguro, ang masasabi ko lang dyan, for example, yung mga researchers na ginagawa on protein sources, so that during times when we have difficulty, for example, in livestock, there will be more alternatives for protein sources. Okay. So there are now researches on vegetables that are rich in protein, no, or other food that are rich in protein. We have, of course, researches so this is alternative in the case of food, you know. In our livestock, for example, we have invested so much in native livestock so that we will not be dependent on imported livestock. So we have now purified certain lines of livestock in among pigs, among ducks, and chicken, and hopefully we can do this in commercial production. There are others, okay, that we can enumerate, but it will take some time to discuss all of them.
Sir, meron pa pong katanungan. Galing po kay Dr. Mark. What is the status of solar energy and wind energy as alternative source of electricity in the Philippines?
Well, in terms of R&D, yung sa solar, ay may mga ginagawang mga pilot-pilot kami kasi ito ginagawa namin mostly as part of our community empowerment through science and technology, you know. So there are two areas where we pilot technologies like yung mga solar na yan. One is as a source of energy or electricity. The other one is our introduction of ways to have rural water supply or clean water supply. Yung iba dyan, gumagamit din ng mga solar for pumping, windmills for pumping, etc. But we are more on the research side. No? So yung tungkol sa actual policy and implementation of programs. So as you can see, this is in the area of the Department of Energy.
Sige po, sir. Pinaka-last na po ng katanungan. Are we considering the nuclear energy?
Yes, we are open to that. Okay, and we have been in the International Atomic Energy Agency since the beginning, more than 70 years. The Philippines is one of the first members of the International Atomic Energy Agency, and we have seen, okay, how the other countries benefited from this. Of course, there is always an element that we have to make sure of, and this is safety. But there are very detailed protocols on determining how safe, okay, is your program, how safe is location, how safe is your facility to be able to get clearance from the IAEA. But we are open to different technologies. Okay.
Thank you po. Again, Secretary De La Peña, napakarami po pong tanong dito at marami pong bumabati. Gaya po ng sabi po rito, congratulations, very informative presentation. Congrats, DOST. Ang dami po sa chat box, sir, mababasa niyo po. Pero maigsi na po yung time natin. Kaya po, before we end, we close this session, I would like to request everyone to please open your cameras sa mga panel section para magkaroon po tayo ng
virtual. Just a word, we would like to encourage the industry associations which are members of PCCI to also communicate with us.
Yes, sir. We will take note on that, sir, para collaboration po talaga. Ayan po yung advocacy namin dito sa education community sa pangunguna po ng aming idol na si Dr. Eduardo Ong. Sige po, buksan na po natin ang ating camera para magkaroon po tayo ng photo opportunity sa ating butihing secretary ng DOST, Secretary De La Peña.
Ayoko naman i-reveal yung age namin ni Dr. Ong, pero 40 years ago magkasama na kami.
Mamaya sa panel screen tayo.